Joining us now is Robert Nicholson, who has a background in law, Hebrew studies, and Middle Eastern history. He's the president and founder of the Philos Project, which seeks to promote positive Christian engagement in the Near East, and has discussed the Israel-Hamas war on his weekly podcast, The Deep Map. Robert, welcome back to News in Depth. Before we discuss Turkey, let's go back to the recent events in Jordan. Representative Moulton from Massachusetts praised the careful and calibrated response from the Biden administration on the drone attack and in its dealings with Iran. How is the U.S. perceived in the region, and is it too strong, too cautious?
The U.S. is perceived as extremely weak and not to be relied upon. And that is the view of both our friends and our enemies, sadly. What people don't understand is that these are not isolated events. It's not an attack in Jordan and Israel's war in Gaza and tensions in Lebanon and problems in the Red Sea. These are all part of one comprehensive strategy that is being coordinated out of Tehran. And it is a region-wide rebellion against the U.S., against Israel, and against our Arab allies in the region. Unfortunately, Iran is seen to be winning. And the United States, to the extent that we are too careful, too calibrated, not willing to push back, is understood to be rolling back its influence at the expense of Iran. And this is going to inflame conflict rather than mitigate it.
As you mentioned, Iran's influence in the region is not limited to the Palestinian territories and its backing of terrorist groups. The Iranian president, Ibrahim Raisi, was in Turkey last week to negotiate economic deals and increase bilateral relations. Why is Turkey such a critical regional partner?
Once upon a time, Turkey was a critical partner for the United States, but that ship has sailed. President Erdogan has been making it his job, really, for the last 20 years, to pull Turkey out of the West and push it more toward the Islamic world, and specifically the Islamist part of the Islamic world. We are approaching next month the 100-year anniversary of the fall of the last caliphate, the Ottoman caliphate in the Middle East. And Erdogan and his Turkey is very much trying to bring that caliphate, that kind of Islamic politics, back. They, unfortunately, although a Sunni power, are willing to make peace and work together with Iran, a Shiite power, not because they love each other, they don't, but because they both agree on one thing, and that is rolling back, as I said, U.S. influence in the region, which they are both actively working to do even today as we speak.
Well, after the attack in a Catholic church in Turkey last weekend, the Bishop of Istanbul expressed concern that this deadly attack may not be the last, a little bit like what you're referencing. What are we seeing as far as interreligious tensions in Turkey or the impact of Iranian influence there?
Iranian influence and Turkish influence go together. They're different, but they are both intent on making the region very, very much the same. They are trying to change the region in their own likeness. Turkey itself is getting very bad. It has been now for a number of years. We saw the Hagia Sophia converted from a museum, used to be a church, now it's a mosque. We're seeing increased persecutions of Turkey, not just through government policy, but as we've seen from the people, these spontaneous acts of terror. Turkey, of course, is a major funder and facilitator of the Muslim Brotherhood, which is causing trouble all over the region. And these days, and for a long time now, Turkey has been supporting Hamas. This is a pattern of behavior that we in the United States need to see, zoom out and see, and craft policies that curb their influence rather than make room for it to expand.
Well, Robert, you just mentioned Hamas. You're also an expert in Christian engagement in the Middle East, specifically with the people of Israel. Reports indicate six United Nations relief workers were part of the wave of Palestinian militants who killed 1,200 people in the deadliest assault on Jews since the Holocaust, and two of them helped to capture hostages. Does this affect the wave of accusations against Israel at the United Nations and pressure from the Biden administration?
It is the best kept secret, the worst kept secret, rather, in the region that the United Nations is actively working and has been for many years against the state of Israel on a number of fronts. This evidence that recently came out about UNRWA employees, and now the number is up to 12 or 13 people, not six, is just the evidence that we need to prove what we already know. Unfortunately, the UN and the Biden administration seem undeterred by the revelation that there are enemies within their own ranks and are, in fact, pressuring Israel, if you can believe it, pressuring Israel, the victim of the massacre of October 7th, to make concessions to the other side. It's unconscionable. It's absolutely wrong. And it's going to help the bad guys, embolden them as they seek to grow at the expense of the good guys. This is a place where the United States, with not a whole lot of effort, could actually shift the needle the other way.
Well, the goal of the Israeli intervention here has been the release of the hostages. It's been 118 days since the hostages were taken, many with serious injuries. What do your contacts tell you about how likely any of them are still alive or that a release is possible?
My heart breaks for the hostages. There are 136 still there, men, women, children, even at least one little baby. The reports I've heard indicate that there are probably 20 to 30 of them already dead. Those who have been released, and there have been hostages who've been released, are now testifying to what they saw in those tunnels under the Gaza Strip, the wholesale maiming, mutilation, the raping, much raping of both men and women is going on all the time. And we need to be, as Christians, praying for them, as Americans, pushing our government to say the only thing that's important to say in this moment. It's not to Israel, it's to Hamas. Release the hostages and this war will end. That has been the message from day one, and it should have been a much more consistent message from the Biden administration. We need to get back to that, because that is the most important thing for anyone who cares about peace and the end of this war in Gaza.
Well, we're certainly praying for peace, but most of all for the families and the hostages. Thank you so much, Robert.
Thank you.